BBC Audio presents Doctor Who, The Smugglers by Terrance Dix, read by Anneke Wills. Chapter 1. A shock for Polly and Ben. A police box stood in a London square up against the railings that surrounded the garden in the centre. There was an out-of-order notice on the door. Police boxes like this were common in the London of the 60s. This, like the others, was a rectangular blue affair with small square windows set high in the sides. Above the door were the words "Police Box" in white lettering, with "Public Call" sandwiched between in smaller letters. Normal police boxes, which this one incidentally was not, had three functions. When the light on the top was flashing, it told any passing policeman that there was a message from HQ. A policeman on the beat could use the phone in the box to call his superiors. And finally, in an emergency, members of the public could use the phone to call for advice or assistance from the police. In time to come, police boxes like this would disappear from the streets, made redundant by the advent of the policeman's personal radio. This particular one was about to disappear of its own accord. An old man strode briskly into the square and came to a halt outside the police box. He stood for a moment, looking up and down the square, as if waiting for someone. He wore a long cloak, fastened at the neck, and a fur hat. Though old, he was still alert and vigorous, and the eyes in the heavily lined face blazed with fierce intelligence. Suddenly, two young people ran into the square. One was a girl in a fashionable denim trouser suit, her long blonde hair tucked beneath a denim cap. With her was a young man in the uniform of an ordinary seaman, bell-bottom trousers, blue raincoat and jersey, close-cropped hair beneath a sailor's hat with HMS Teaser on the ribbon. The old man looked at them and scowled. It was clear that they were not whoever he'd been waiting for, but he greeted them politely enough, and they talked for a few minutes, then made their farewells. The two young people hurried away, and the old man watched them go. Then he began fumbling in his pockets for a key, but he couldn't find it. After going through all his pockets with increasing irritation, the old man reached carefully into a concealed inner pocket and produced what was obviously a spare. Carefully removing the notice from its hook, he opened the door of the police box and disappeared inside. All this had been watched by the two young people, who had paused at the edge of the square for a last look back. Suddenly, the young man smote his forehead in the age-old "I forgot" gesture, took a key from his pocket and showed it to the girl. They ran to the police box, but by this time the old man had gone inside and shut the door. There was a moment of heated discussion, and the girl pointed vigorously at the key. After a moment, the young sailor shrugged and gave in. He tried the key in the police box lock. It fitted, and he turned it and opened the door. He ushered the girl inside and then followed her, closing the door behind them. Seconds later, the light on top of the police box started to flash. Then, with a strange, wheezing, groaning sound, the police box simply disappeared, much to the amazement of a couple of passing tourists. Inside the police box, Polly's hand went to her mouth. Good heavens! Polly was a young secretary, a typical dolly bird of the swinging 60s, and she'd just come through a particularly terrifying adventure. In a nightclub called The Inferno, she had encountered her present companion, Ben, a young Cockney sailor on leave, and a young girl called Dodo, who seemed to be travelling with a strange old man known only as the Doctor. All three had subsequently become involved in the extraordinary affair of the war machines. These were the creations of a power-crazed computer called Wotan, who had planned to use them to take over first London and then the world. The doctor, who seemed to be a scientist with an extraordinary range of talents, had finally put paid to the war machines. His companion Dodo had decided to stop travelling with him and go back to live with her aunt. She'd sent this message, together with her farewells, by way of Polly and Ben. But once they'd delivered it and said goodbye to the doctor themselves, Ben had remembered that the doctor had dropped his key some time ago and had rushed off before Ben could return it. Urged on by Polly, who was consumed with curiosity about the doctor and the police box, Ben had used the key to get them inside. Now, her curiosity satisfied, Polly stood looking around her in utter astonishment. She shook her head wonderingly. "Good heavens!" she said again. Considering what she was seeing, the comment was rather inadequate. She should have been in the cramped surroundings of a police box, jammed in together with Ben and the old man known as the doctor. But she wasn't. Instead, she stood at the entrance to a large, brightly lit control room. In its centre was a many-sided control console, an affair of complicated-looking instrument panels arranged around a transparent centre column, itself packed with complex electronic circuitry. Various odds and ends were dotted about the room: a hat stand, old-fashioned chairs, some rather odd-looking statues. The doctor was busy at the control console, and he swung round at the sound of Polly's voice. He had taken off hat, coat, and scarf, revealing check trousers, old-fashioned boots, and a frock coat worn with a cravat and a high wing collar. His whole appearance, shabby, scholarly, with a pronounced 19th-century feel to it, contrasted strangely with his ultra-modern surroundings. Ben was equally amazed. "Blimey, where did all this come from? It was a police box, wasn't it?"
"I think so," said Polly uncertainly.
The doctor was glaring at them in indignation.
"What are you doing here? How did you get inside?"
Polly pointed to the key in Ben's hand.
"You dropped your key."
Ben held out the key.
"That's right."
The doctor snatched it from his hand.
"How dare you follow me aboard the TARDIS?"
Ben stared at him.
"Aboard the what?" "TARDIS," snapped the doctor. "It is a vessel for travelling in time and space. Now, why did you follow me?"
"We're terribly sorry if we've annoyed you, Doctor," said Polly placatingly. "It was my idea, I'm afraid."
Ben wandered over to the control console.
"What's all this for, then?"
The doctor shooed him away.
"Come away from there. Do you want to cause even more trouble than you have already? Those particular controls are for dematerialisation."
"And what does that mean?"
The doctor pointed to the centre column, which was rising and falling steadily.
"Something you and this young lady have just experienced. You are now travelling in time and space."
Ben looked at him for a moment and then burst out laughing.
"Just make sure I'll get back by tea time, Doctor. I've got to report back to my ship by midnight."
Ben was a seaman at the end of what had turned out to be a very eventful spell of leave. The doctor gave him a malevolent smile.
"I'm afraid it will be a very long time before you see your ship again, young man."
With a shock, Ben realised that the doctor was perfectly serious.
"When are we going to land?" asked Polly nervously.
The doctor sighed.
"I wish I knew. This is the worst part of any journey. I never know."
"Why not?"
The doctor scowled.
"Because I have no control over where I go, nor can I choose the period in which I land."
He looked hard at the centre column, which was rising and falling more slowly now.
"Stand by. We are about to materialise."
They watched as the column slowed to a halt. The doctor...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.